So now we're going to talk about probably one of the most anxiety driving situations a healthcare professional could get into, and that's pulseless arrest cases with pediatrics. In this case, we're going to be talking about ventricular fibrillation. Now, trauma or severe injury is one of the leading causes of out-of-hospital cardiac arrest in children. Even so, the treatment for a pediatric trauma victim in cardiac arrest is the same as a child in non-traumatic cardiac arrest. We're going to support circulation, airway, and breathing. This, with the exception that in the case where the arrest is due to a mechanical form of shock and treatment can be performed immediately to relieve the cause of the obstructive shock, we're still going to follow the same algorithm. Ventricular fibrillation, known as VFib, and pulseless ventricular tachycardia, known as VTAC, are lethal dysrhythmias that do not produce a pulse. VFib is the most common initial dysrhythmia in cardiac arrest and will regress to a systole if it's not treated right away. The key steps to treating VFib are a rapid assessment to confirm cardiac arrest, starting CPR, and applying the defibrillator and delivering the first shock as soon as possible. Getting to the first shock early on is important, as statistically, every minute that defibrillation is delayed, the chance of survival is reduced by about 10%. Now, for a child or infant, high-quality CPR needs to be performed with as few interruptions as possible by giving cycles of 15 compressions, at least one-third the depth of the chest, at a rate of 100 to 120 compressions per minute. This followed by two full rescue breaths to get chest rise and fall. This is going to be about 2 inches deep on a child or 1.5 inches deep for an infant when it comes to compression depth. The compressor needs to be changed every 2 minutes to avoid fatigue, which could lead to less effective CPR compressions. So after the initial defibrillation shock, an IV or IO needs to be established in order to give medications. The first medication given would be epinephrine, 1 to 10,000, and that's going to be given 0.01 milligrams per kilogram, IV or IO push, every 3 to 5 minutes. Keep in mind that a 20 cc bolus of normal saline should be pushed after that so that we get the medication into the circulatory system of the patient. After the initial dose of epinephrine and a second shock is given, consider placing an advanced airway with capnography. Remember that once an advanced airway is in place, CPR compressions become continuous at 100 to 120 compressions per minute, and one breath is given every 2 to 3 seconds, synchronized with those compressions. Now, if the patient remains in persistent VFib after the initial shocks and epinephrine administration, the next medication to be given is amiodarone, 5 milligrams per kilogram via rapid IV or IO push. Two more doses of amiodarone may be repeated. Successful treatment of VFib continues with high-quality CPR, reassessing the patient's cardiac rhythm every 2 minutes, delivering a shock if VFib is present, and giving medications as indicated. Now, another side note is that any pulseless arrest, such as VFib, VTAC, or PEA, or even asystole for that matter, needs to include nearly continuous CPR. The only thing that should cause an interruption is brief rhythm checks. Remember, we don't want to interrupt CPR to administer drugs. IO and IV drugs need to be given while those chest compressions are actually being done in order to get the drug circulated to the heart and throughout the body and also keep good circulation to vital organs and tissues. Aggressive and non-interrupted CPR is showing great improvements to patient outcomes and, more importantly, improved post-resuscitation quality of life.